So there is a broad consensus in the scientific community that if temperature were to increase by more than 2 degrees above pre-industrial levels, the economic, social, and environmental consequences would be catastrophic for the planet. So if we want to reach, if we want to be able to limit temperature increase to 2 degrees, we have a carbon budget over the next 40 years. We cannot emit, we should not emit more than 1,100 billions of tons of CO2s over the next 40 years. At the moment, we emit between 35 and 40 billions of tons of CO2 every year, but this number is growing quickly with the fast development of emerging markets. So if we want to address this issue, if we want to have a chance to address this issue, we should increase explicitly or implicitly the cost of emitting CO2. The underlying assumptions here being that we should, in a way, re-internalize the negative externalities of, you know, emitting CO2. At the moment, a very conservative estimate of what the price of 1 ton of CO2, the cost of 1 ton of CO2, you know, the long-term cost of emitting 1 ton of CO2, is this price is about $40 per ton. It's an estimate from the U.S. government, but again, this is a very conservative estimate. If you look at where the price stands at the moment, you know, in the different trading scheme that exists on the planet, the only real trading scheme, the only mechanism where carbon is priced is the European Emission Trading Scheme. And at the moment, you have to pay less than $10 to emit one single ton of CO2. And even in that mechanism, there are a number of industries that have some kind of a derogatory treatment and that don't have to pay anything else. Even worse than that, there are some countries, particularly oil-producing countries, that subsidize the consumption of oil, and this results de facto in a negative price for CO2. So clearly, when you look at what the situation is, no or low or even negative price for emitting CO2 and where we should go, that is to say, at the minimum, a price of $40 per ton of CO2, the price will have to increase in a way or in another if we want to avoid these catastrophic consequences due to temperature increase. So the quality of CO2 reporting has significantly improved over the past few years. It has improved for two reasons. The first reason is that there is now a broadly used carbon or CO2 or more generally speaking, greenhouse gas reporting standard. This standard is called the GHG for greenhouse gas protocol. It's a standard that you know, defines how companies should measure, calculate, and ultimately report, disclose the carbon footprint for which they are directly or indirectly responsible. So it's a good thing to have a standard, but if nobody uses it, it's pointless. So the second reason why the carbon reporting has greatly improved is that there is a not-for-profit organization, which is called the Carbon Disclosure Project, or CDP. This organization is supported by more than 800 institutional investors across the planet, representing slightly less than $100 trillion in assets. And this organization asks every year more than 5,000 companies across the planet to report their CO2 emissions as well as other environmental, you know, data. Obviously, you can imagine that if you are a company and you receive the questionnaire from this organization and this organization is telling you that it is supported by very, very large institutional investors, you have a strong incentive to answer. And so the combination of a clear reporting standard and clear incentives for a company to report their CO2 and other greenhouse gas emissions has led to a significant improvement in the quality of you know, CO2 reporting. So obviously, CO2 low carbon investment strategies are about responsible investing, because you can say that the carbon intensity of your portfolio is lower than what it would be if you were investing in plain vanilla, you know, capitalization weighted indices. So clearly it's about responsible investing. But we also believe that low carbon investment strategies at the moment represent a very good opportunity to outperform the markets. We believe they represent a good opportunity to outperform the market because these strategies offer you a very similar exposure to the market than capitalization weighted indices. They will have roughly the same sector exposure, the same country exposure, the same style exposure. The only difference will be that they will be underexposed, underweighted on what we call these carbon risk factors. So that if eventually carbon is repriced or the price of CO2 increase, the companies that are carbon intensive will be penalized. But since these strategies are underexposed to this type of strategies, they will tend to outperform on a relative basis. So again, low carbon investment strategies are really about responsible investments, but also and above all about, you know, generating outperformance. So low carbon investment strategies or, you know, clean type of strategies used to be seen as niche strategies because they were limited to a few companies that were, you know, indeed investing in clean tech, these kind of technologies. At the moment, again, since the quality of carbon reporting has significantly improved, we are able to design mainstream strategies. The strategies we are talking about, again, they have, you know, same exposure, roughly the same exposures as cap-weighted indices. They have roughly the same capacity. They have roughly the same liquidity. So that we are seeing more and more investors entirely switching their allocation to traditional, for example, passive, cap-weighted index replication to low-carbon investment strategies. Because again, these strategies have the same capacity, same liquidity, roughly the same exposure in terms of sectors, so that there are no issues as far as fiduciary duties are concerned, because you get again the same exposure as the broad markets. So again, we're seeing a lot of institutional investors, particularly French pension funds, Swedish pension funds, entirely switching to low carbon investment strategies. So from the point of view of our methodology, the methodology that we have developed, we are able on the equity side to decarbonize any portfolio that would have a sufficiently large number of stocks. The techniques we are applying are quantitative techniques where we're going to screen across the investment universe for the companies that have, you know, the best, or if you look at the other way around, the worst carbon footprint. And we can apply this type of methodology to any broad-based portfolio. So it can be obviously traditional index, such as MSCI World, but also smart beta indices, because smart beta indices, you know, minimum variance indices, they have a very large number of stocks. So we can apply the same quantitative methodology. And we actually did it for a French pension fund that told us that he had a smart beta allocation and he wanted to, analyze whether it was possible to decarbonize it, and we actually did it. But we could also think about decarbonizing broad-based portfolios, that is to say active, you know, equity portfolio that have a sufficiently large number of companies. So they should, I guess, get in touch with us, and we would be extremely happy to answer all their questions and provide some analysis of their portfolios.